Good evening, dear women. Chanukah Sameach. I would like to tell you that this lesson, the Torah lesson, is going to be dedicated to Lulu Nishmat. Amen. And Lulu Nishmat. Amen. I would like to tell you. I would like to tell you, dear women, that because for my sorrow and all of us, bad news we received, so you know when things like this happen, we should try to take a mitzvah upon ourselves. And I would like each one of us, bli neder, to think about something that we, you know, with a mitzvah that we want to do that, but we don't do that perfectly, and just take it upon ourselves, that Leilu Nishmat, those people, Bezrat Hashem, we will take the mitzvah upon ourselves. Do you understand? If we do not do usually the Netilat Yadayim before the Suda, before the meal, if we do not do the blessings, if we have to take a mitzvah upon ourselves, if we know that sometimes our tongue runs away and does whatever it wants without us thinking before that, we should tell ourselves that now we are going to pay attention. And every word that comes out of our mouth, bli neder, we will try to weigh her and to decide what we are saying in order not to slander anyone or do something bad to anyone else. As bli neder, we should take a mitzvah upon ourselves. Even reading Perek Shira or reading a few chapters of Tehillim every day, if you did not do that, maybe start doing that. And Be'ezrat Hashem, this is Le'ilui Nishmat. And this Be'ezrat Hashem helps that soul elevate in the next world. And I would like to tell you, Be'ezrat Hashem, I would like to say that this shiur, which is going to be mainly about Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, I would like, Be'ezrat Hashem, that his merit will be for the children of Israel. That the fire in the land of Israel will stop, Be'ezrat Hashem. And Be'ezrat Hashem, there will be blessing rains in the land of Israel. And I would like to wish that Yegei Mashiach, Tzidkenu Bimra Bimeinu, Amen, Eliyahu Navi, Eliyahu Tishbeleyahu Gledi Mimra Mashiach Ben David, Eliyahu Navi Zachur Latov, Amen, Ken Yei Ratzon. First of all, this Shabbat is Shabbat Miketz. The portion of the week is Miketz. We are going to read about yourself, that you'll see that Paro takes him quickly out of the jail because he hears that he knows how to solve dreams. You remember that Yosef was hated because of his dreams, and because of a dream he goes out of jail. And then we see everything that happens. There's hunger in the land of Israel. His brothers come to Egypt. And this is mainly in big the story about Parashat Miketz. I'm going to give you bli neder the connection between Parashat Miketz, which is usually read on the Shabbat of Chanukah, between that and Chanukah, the miracles of Chanukah, bli neder. But when we finish about Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, first, this Shabbat is Shabbat Mevarchim. Mevarchim Rosh Chodesh Tevet. Dear women, please read Tehillim. This is Shabbat Mevarchim Rosh Chodesh Tevet. Please, the month, the Jewish month of Tevet, please read Tehillim, the whole book. If you can, just, you know, divide the book between your children, yourself, your neighbors, anyone that you have, in order to finish the book on time, on Shabbat. It's a big merit to finish the book of Tehillim on Shabbat Mevarchim. And I would like to remind you, you remember that I told you that the Bnei Sakhar asked, why do the children of Israel daven and their prayers are not answered? And it says because they do not know the name of God for that month. So the month of Tevet, the combination of Yud Kei Vav Kei is Kuf Yud Kuf Vav and Kuf Aleph Kuf Vav. You remember? Kuf Yud, sorry. It says Baruch, when we come to Tfilat Musaf, Musaf Shel Rosh Chodesh. When we come to the davening of Musaf, we have Rosh Chodesh on the days Tuesday and Wednesday. So next week we'll have Chanukah party and Be'ezrat Hashem also Rosh Chodesh. So we're going to celebrate both of them. Okay. Yom Shlishi v'Ravi. Yomayim Rosh Chodesh. It's 2 days Rosh Chodesh. It's on Tuesday and on Wednesday. On Monday night is the Eve of Rosh Chodesh. So Tuesday and Wednesday morning, we do Shacharit Shel Rosh Chodesh and Musaf Shel Rosh Chodesh. Yeah, it starts Monday night. So we have the Musaf of Rosh Chodesh. And all the davening of of Amidah, which means Tfilat Shmona Esre, we come to the sentence that says Baruch Ata Hashem Mekadesh Yisrael Verashei Chodashim. So I told you, when you come to Baruch Ata Hashem, you say the name of God, but over here you mechaven those letters of Hashem. This is the name of God for the month of Tevet. Okay? So tell that to your husbands, to your sons. This gives prosperity. When we do that, it gives us health, parnasa tova, happiness, everything that we wish for, Bezrat Hashem letova. So it's very important, lechaven, just to see in front of your eyes the letters. Do not pronounce it. Just see in front of your eyes the letters.
Tuesday, Shacharit.
Yes, Musaf Shal Rosh Chodesh. After, you know, you have Shacharit, then they're reading in the Torah, and then you have, yes. But this Rosh Chodesh is very special. Because, you know, when we have Rosh Chodesh, we say Ya'aleh V'yavo. We say that also in Birkat HaMazon. But over here, it's also Chanukah. It's Rosh Chodesh and Chanukah. So we say Ala Nisim. We say Ya'aleh V'yavo V'ala Nisim. In the davening, and also when we say Birkat HaMazon. So please pay attention, remind yourselves, okay? It's very important. And please, lechaven, lechaven, which means see the names in front, see the letters in front of you when you say Baruch Ata Hashem, Mekadesh Yisrael, Verashei Chodashim. So over here, when you say Hashem, just see the letters in front of your eyes. מה? כן. And אבל זה עוד מה? אני אתן בסוף השיעור, אתן את החוקים של. Okay, dear women. Everybody wrote it? Baruch Hashem. Now we are going.
Can you read this for me? I give my son in my.
Yes. At the end of the lesson, I'll write for you.
No. This word.
This.
Yes.
You want me now or then? Oh, give me a paper.
Thank you.
So basically, just to have in mind, at this time the Musaf and Tuesday and Wednesday prayers,
yes,
we should have in mind when it comes to Hashem's name that these words should come to our minds.
Exactly.
And we can pray for
this is the combination. You do not have to say anything. You just say Baruch Ata Hashem. When you say the name of God over here, in front of your eyes you should see those names. The two combinations of the name, the letters are in a different place. It should be Yud Kei, Vav Kei.
And these are the names of Hashem for this month, right?
For this month. And you do that only on the Musaf of Rosh Chodesh.
Coming
okay?
But they don't know the Iris, tell them that K is for Hey.
Oh, I'll tell them. Thank you. Don't forget that I'm writing Kuf over here, but you know that it's a hay, okay? Please do not forget that. Okay, let's continue. Shh. I would like to start with Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, but I would like to have all of your attention. Now, I'm going to teach you a new phrase in Hebrew that is called Lotzi Yakar Mizolel. Lehotzi Yakar Mizolel. Which means to extract a good spirit out of an evil one. This is Lotzi Yakar Mizolel. Ken. Shu nizon mimena. To extract good from evil. Now I will connect this to Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, and more than that, even to his father-in-law. You know who was his father-in-law of Rabbi Meir Baal Haness? Rabbi Chanina ben Tardayon. You know, he was one of Aseret Rogei Malchut, the 10 Tanaim that was killed by the Romans. So he was one of them, his father-in-law. And we are going to speak about it, and we're going to connect it to Parashat Vayishlach in Chumash Bereshit. And look how beautiful the stories are. First of all, how was Rabbi Meir Baal Haness born? Where did he come from? Okay, let's start. So I would like to tell you what is the story behind the birth of Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. So it goes back to the ruining of the temple. And there's a story about Kamtsa, Bebal Kamtsa. It says over there that there were two people in Jerusalem. One of them was called Kamtsa, and the other one was called Bal Kamtsa. And one day, one of the very important people in the city of Jerusalem made a big feast, a big party, and he invited all of the important people in Jerusalem to his party. Now he had a friend whose name was Kamtsa. He was his best friend. And he took the messenger, you know, when you give invitations, he was rich, so he took a messenger and he sent all of the invitations. And he told him, give this invitation to Kamtsa, my friend, so he will be invited to the party. But a messenger made a mistake, and instead of giving that letter to Kamtsa, he gave the letter to Bal Kamtsa. Bal Kamtsa was the enemy of that person. You're the owner of the party, he was the enemy of that person. He hated him. They hated each other. So it says that Bal Kamtsa came with the invitation to the party. And you know, the owner of the party, the one that did the party, came and he sees his enemy, his hated enemy, sitting in his party. So he came to him and he told him, excuse me, he says, what are you doing here? So he says, you invited me. He says, well, I did not invite you. How can I invite you? I hate you with all of my heart and you hate me. We are enemies. How can I invite you? He said, I invited Kamtsa. He says, I don't know what happened, but the messenger gave me the invitation. So please, he said, don't embarrass me. I will pay for my meal. He says, no, you have to go away. He said, you know what? I will pay for half of the party. He said, no, you have to go. He said, I will pay the whole party. Just don't do any scene over here. Don't embarrass me. So the owner said no. He took him by the hand and he took him out of the party in front of everyone. Bal Kamtsa went out and he said, wow, there were big sages over there, big scholars, Talmidei Chachamim, they were sitting over there. They saw what happened and none of them protested. They did not say, that's not right. This is not the right thing to do. None of them protested. So he said, if they did not protest, I'm going to be even with them. So he went to the Roman Caesar, to the king, and he said, I would like to tell you, I'm Jewish. I know that the Jewish people do not respect you. They do not honor you. They do bad things behind your back. He says, why should I believe you? Maybe you want to revenge someone. He said, no, I will show you. So the king said, what do you want me to do? He said, bring a sacrifice to the temple. So the king brought a sacrifice to the temple. He gave it to Bal Kamtsa to bring it to the high priests so they can sacrifice the sacrifice on the altar. Now it's halakha that we can, even goyim can bring sacrifice to the temple, to the holy temple, and we do sacrifice them. Because this means that they acknowledge Hashem. Wait. They will bring everything kosher. They also know it has to be kosher. So he brought the sacrifice, and the sacrifice was kosher. It didn't have any default in him. So what did Bal Kamtsa do? He took the sacrifice, and he made a cut in his mouth, and some say a cut in his eye, above his eye. Now the king did not know about it. And Bal Kamtsa came to the priest. He knew they cannot offer this sacrifice on the altar because this is a Zeyesh Bomum, Bal Mum. He has a default. It can't be sacrificed. Now the priest knew that only Bal Kamtsa did it. It doesn't come from the king because they do know, or even the goyim, they know that they have to bring a clean sacrifice. It has to be holy. So they decided, what shall we do, they said. It's a big problem, because if we won't sacrifice, then there will be a ruining of the children of Israel in the land of Israel, and wherever they are. So they decided, Bishvil Shlom Malchut, in order that there will be peace and nobody will know, they will sacrifice the sacrifice. But then came Rabbi Ischaya ben Avkilus, and he said, no, you cannot do that, because other people will not know that you sacrificed Bishvil Shlom Malchut for the peace of the kingdom. They will think that it's allowed to bring a sacrifice with default in it. So they said, no, you cannot do that. He said, you cannot do that. So they said, what shall we do? So So we need to kill Bar Kamtza, because we know he will go back to the king, the Roman king. He will tell him that we did not sacrifice the sacrifice, and that will be a big problem to the Jewish people. So then Rabbi Zcharia said, you cannot do that. Then everybody will say that if you bring a sacrifice with a default on it, you're allowed to kill that person. Nobody knows the true story. We all know, only we know that. So they will think that you're allowed to do that. So then the rabbi said, the priest said over there, that because of the modesty and because of the righteousness of Rabbi Zcharia, because of that, the second temple was ruined. What happened, Bar Kamtza came to the Roman Caesar and he said, you see, the Jewish people do not respect you. They did not offer your sacrifice on the altar. And once he heard that, man.
In the end, they did that for Shalom.
No, they did not do that. They did not do that for Shlom Malchut, and they did not kill Bar Kamtza. Because Rabbi Zcharia ben Afkilus told them, if you tarvu oto lishlom malchut, kulam yachshavu shemutar lavi korban shesh bo mum, bal mum. אז לא יכלו לעשות את זה. וכשאמרו שיהרגו את בר קמצא, אמרו, אז יחשבו שמי שמביא בעל מום צריך להוציא אותו להורג, שזה דין מלכות. לכן לא עשו את זה. And because of that, Caesar decided to send Neron. Neron was a big general, big Roman general, to ruin Jerusalem. And it says he came to the gates of Jerusalem. And he was a big, big general. And he had a lot of conquerings and a lot of winning wars that he had behind him. And he came to Jerusalem, but he said, this is the place that the God of the Jewish people is. How come I can conquer this city? So he decided to try something. He took bows and arrows and he went from all sides. And he took the bow and arrow, and instead of aiming it in towards the city, he aimed it to a different place. And all the arrows went inside the city, inside Jerusalem, all of them. So he knew that this is a sign that he's going to conquer the city of Jerusalem. He knew it's a sign. But then he wasn't sure with himself. You see, when God wants somebody to feel, not to feel comfortable with himself, but something he has to know, he wasn't sure. So he decided that he's going to sit in Okochel Bet Rabban, the children that go out of the yeshiva, and he's going to ask them, what did you learn today? So he saw a few children, and they saw him, and they saw the soldiers, they were very afraid. And he called one of them. And he came to him and he asked him, what did you study in Bebet HaMidrash, in your yeshiva? And the child said, we studied from the book of Yechezkel the prophet. And he said, this is what we studied. It says, "V'natati nikmati be'edom be'yad ami Yisrael." And I'm going to revenge Edom with the hand of my people Israel, he says. So Neron said to himself, wow, God wants me to conquer this city because Romans are Edom. They are part of Edom. He wants me to conquer this city, and then he's going to revenge. He's going to kill me and my family. He's going to have his revenge on me. No, that won't be. So he was sitting and thinking, and he decided that won't be. The same night, it's written that he left his soldiers. He left the army. He ran away. He converted to Judaism. He became Jewish. And one of his descendants is Rabbi Meir Balanes. He is the great-grandfather of Rabbi Meir Balanes. Look how Zenika, this is called Lotzia Kar Mizolel, which means to extract good from evil. A good soul was inside a bad person, but I already told you, the Arizal says that usually what happens because of the sin of the first human being, Adam HaRishon, all of the good souls, some of them, went inside the evil, Sitra Achar, and went inside evil people. Now it's over there because they live from it. You understand? Because I told you that evil cannot survive without good. It has to have good inside it in order. It eats from that. It's a nizon mize. It survives because of that. Yes, it nourishes it. So it's very important for that. But look how God made it. It's a matter of time and place which God made, rings the bell. And from this Neron, which was a Roman general, he converted to Judaism, and his great-great-grandson was Rabbi Meir Balanes. Look, so this is Lotzi Yakar Mizolels, and it says that Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, you know, his name wasn't Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. Okay, I will explain the name. Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, Chutot Hagen Aleinu. Look, Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. Chazal say, I'll explain where Baal Haness, the one with the miracles, and Meir, which enlightens the children of Israel, brings light. It says, Lo Rabbi Meir Shmo, Ela Rabbi Nehorai Shmo. His name was Rabbi Nehorai. His true name was Nehorai. Nehorai. That was his name. And it says like this, Umadu Anikra Shmo Rabbi Meir. Why did they call him Rabbi Meir? So Chazal says, Shehaya Meir Enehem Shel Yisrael Betorah Uvehalacha. Because he used to enlighten the spiritual eyes of the children of Israel with Torah and the Jewish laws. It says that he had a lot of parables. The people could not leave the sight of him when he started speaking about Torah. They used to sit down and his face was shining. Light came out of his face. Vaya Meir, that's why he was called Meir. Because he enlightened the eyes, the spiritual eyes of the Jewish people. Thank you. So just think about it, how a big person he was. And you know who were his rabbis? So you remember that 24,000 students of Rabbi Akiva passed away during the time between Pesach and Shavuot. And this is Sfirat HaOmer. And until today, we have minhagim that are concerned with this. So it says that Rabbi Akiva saw that the Torah was little by little, there are not any more scholars that can teach Torah to the children of Israel. Because 24,000 scholars passed away in a big plague. So it says, it's a beautiful thing, it says that it became like a spiritual desert, shmama, which was spiritual nothingness, because there wasn't anyone that will continue the Torah. So Rabbi Akiva decided that he has to find new students. So he went, it says, to Bnei Brak. And it says over there, please, the phones, lower them. So he went to Bnei Brak and he took five, some say seven students, some say five students. Between those students were Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Yosei, Rabbi Yehuda Ben Ilai, and Rabbi Nechamia was one of the students. He took them and look what he said. And I'm quoting. He said, Banai harishonim niftaru b'magefa. He says, my first sons, they were his sons. You know, rabbi who teaches Torah, all of his students are his sons. That's the same thing. We are all over here the same. So he says, my first sons, God forbid, passed away. All of them passed away because they did not treat each other with respect. Lo nagu kavod ze baze. So he says, you, al natasu kemasem, please do not do what they did. Share your Torah with each other. Don't have pride. Don't think that you are better than others. Ela share it. Think about each one of the people that is around you, that they are your brothers, your sisters. So he taught him Torah. There was another rabbi, Rabbi Shmuel ben Elisha, taught to him also Torah. And then there was another rabbi, Rabban Gamliel, and then Elisha ben Avuya. Elisha ben Avuya is known that he was called the Acher, which means he did not have a place in the next world. He was a big scholar. He taught Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. But then it says that he went into the Pardes, he went to spiritual higher levels, and he saw what he saw. He saw, when he went up, he saw the angel Metatron, and he saw him sitting down and writing in a book. So he thought there are shtei rashuyot, like there are two kings. And because he came to a mistake, that's why it says that you're not allowed to touch the Zohar and things only after you're 40 years old. But today it's a different time, because this is the times of Mashiach. So this is the time that the Kabbalah should be spread all over. Because the Kabbalah is the secrets, and this is the Zohar HaKadosh. The Zohar HaKadosh, this is the Kabbalah. It's the Kabbalah itself. So it says he came to a mistake, and because of that he was called Acher, a different one. You know, like Elohim Acherim, a different one. And Rabbi Elisha ben Avuya. And it says that Rabbi Meir Baal Haness all the time wanted to help him to do tshuva. And he did what Nehron Caesar did. He went to little children, asked them. He went with Elisha ben Avuya, and he asked them, what did you study today? And some of them said exactly, look how the sentences belong to a person. And the children said, "Belarashaim lo yesh shalom," which means there's no peace for wicked people. God has not given them peace. And then he says from Tehillim that why you wicked people try to say what I said in the Torah, because you do not do anything. You go in behind my back and make adultery. You slam the people behind my back. So he says, you are not allowed, wicked people, to have my name in your mouth. Because I already told you that the mouth is very holy. And everything that we take out of our mouth is Dvar Kedusha. It's supposed to be Kedusha. So he saw that there's a big problem for Elisha ben Avuya, which was his rabbi. And he davened to Hashem that Hashem will take him to Geinom, Elisha ben Avuya, in order that he can fix his soul and will have part in the next world. And it says that from his grave, after Rabbi Meir Baal Haness passed away, from the grave of Elisha ben Avuya, and you could see fire, you know, the Ashan, smoke comes out from the grave just to see that the words of Rabbi Meir Baal Haness came true. You know, a word of a tzaddik doesn't go away. It comes true because the more a person is in a higher spiritual level, the words that he takes out of his mouth really come true in this world. He can change. He can change things in this world for better, and vice versa, and also from the other side, God forbid. So now that we know that, let's continue. Rabbi Akiva saw that Rabbi Meir Baal Haness was an excellent student. He knew everything. He was a big scholar. So he decided to make him a rabbi. He gave him a smicha. When I say smicha, I mean that he made him a rabbi. Now you have to know, it's not like today. It used to be that only a righteous person can test another student, and if he sees that he is worthy of the word rabbi, then he will give him the title rabbi. And I would like to tell you, it goes back until Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu taught Yeshua ben Nun, and he gave Yeshua ben Nun that title, that now yesh lo smicha. Smicha means that he can now judge. He can be a judge, and he can judge even penalties for money and everything because he knows the laws. And it goes from one righteous person to another. That's how it used to be. So, dear women, it comes to this time, which I'm telling you at the time of Rabbi Akiva, and you know that 24,000 scholars passed away, so they did not have anyone to continue. It was a big problem. So he gave a smicha to Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. And Rabbi Meir Baal Haness was young, so the other rabbis did not call him a rabbi because he was still young. And because of that, it was only an honorable title, not a true title. But that I have another sage, another Tana, that is called Rabbi Yehuda ben Baba. And you remember, I already told you about him. He was a big rabbi, and he gave smicha to 5 students. Between them was Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Yosei, and Rabbi Yehuda ben Ilai, and he gave them smicha. The Romans said they did not want the smicha to continue. They wanted to stop the spiritual life of the Jewish people. So if they don't have teachers, they don't have any spiritual life, they won't know. If you don't know your own Judaism, your own where you came from, then you, little by little, you become Mityaven, you become Romai, you become exactly what they want. You won't believe, God forbid, in Hashem. So it says that Rabbi Yehuda ben Baba looked for a place, because the Romans said, a person who will teach smicha to someone, he will be killed. That person that will become a rabbi, he will be killed. The city that they taught in will be killed. Everybody will be killed. All the houses will be broken. They will make a desert out of the city. But more than that, even 2,000 amma from the city, you know, around the city, all the trees, all the mountains, they said, they are going to ruin everything. There will be nothing. It will be a desert. So it was a big problem, because you do not want others to be punished for you. You are willing to sacrifice yourself, but then others, it's a big responsibility. So he went to Shfaram, Shfaram in Israel, a place that is called Shfaram, and between Shfaram and another city, which was called Osha, between both of them, there were 2 towns, but they were far away. And there wasn't, and he did not teach in a city, but he taught between those 2 towns, where there was nothing anyway. So he taught them and he gave them smicha, and the Romans heard about it and they came, and he told his students to run away. He stayed over there, and 300 spears, he was one of Aseret Harugei Malchut, was stabbed inside of him, like he became a filter, because 300 spears were inside him. They made him like a filter, all holes. But still, he did a big mitzvah. He made a smicha gdola for 5 rabbis that can spread the Torah. Look, what, God forbid, if he didn't do that, we would have a problem today. So, but,
why they died like this?
I already told you by Aseret Harugei Malchut that this was a decree from Hashem, from heavens. This was a decree because of Yosef. Because of Yosef, you're talking about the ten Tanaim that were killed by the Romans in very wicked ways and very cruel ways. This was a decree from Hashem because of what happened with Yosef at Tzaddik, because he was sold, and because of the ten sperms that went out of him because of the wife of Potipharah. So this is a, look, it goes, every sin, we are all, until today, we are fixing the sin of the Adam HaRishon, of the first human being in Chava, until now. We did not finish with it. So I would like to tell you, dear women, one of Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes students is called Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi. You know, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi was a big scholar. Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi says, I became a big scholar because I was sitting behind Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes. So the energy that came from him, I was sitting and receiving it. That's why I became so wise, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi says. Because Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi was the one that wrote the Mishnah. You know the Mishnah that we have today, because he saw after the ruining of the Second Temple, he was afraid that the Torah, the oral Torah, will be forgotten. Because it used to go, look how wise we used to be. It used to go from mouth to ear, and everybody remembered everything, but nothing was written. So after that, they had to write it in order that we will not forget it. So he wrote the Mishnah and Rav Ashi, the Gemara. So he says, I became such a scholar because of Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes, because I was sitting behind him. Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes had 2 sons. They passed away in his life, in his lifetime. We'll speak in a few minutes about it. And then he had 1 daughter. He used to say, "Hizaru b'panai b'fnei biti." She was a very smart daughter, and his student married his daughter. And now I would like to tell you about his father-in-law. It says that Rabbi Chanina ben Tardayon, I don't know if you remember, but you remember the ten Aseret Harugei Malchut, the 10 Tanaim that were killed by the Romans. He was one of them. Rabbi Chanina ben Tardayon. He had 2 daughters. One of the daughters was called Buria. I would like to tell you, she was so smart, Buria, that in the Gemara she's mentioned. She's mentioned in various places in the Gemara. She's mentioned in Masechet Brachot. She's mentioned in Masechet Eruvin. She's mentioned in Masechet Psachim. She's mentioned over there because she knew the Jewish laws al Borian. It's more than that. When Rabbi Yehuda would say a Jewish law, and Buria had a comment about it, she would write it on a piece of paper she would give him. If he saw that she was right, he used to say, Buria tzadka mimeni, and he would tell this law to everyone. And she was a woman. She was a woman. So she was very smart. And she was the wife of Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes.
She was the wife?
Yes, she was the wife of Rabbi Meir Baal HaNes. Just a minute, please. So let's come. No. כולם היו ספרדים, כולם באו מבבל, מעיראק. אברהם אבינו בא מבבל, הוא עיראקי. הוא הגיע מבבל. מתי התחילו אשכנזים וספרדים? אחרי הגלות של בית שני, כשפיזרו אותנו, אז חלק לארצות אשכנז, לאירופה וכולי, וחלק אפריקה, פשוט התפזרנו. בחלק ניכר מיהדות אשכנז זה גרים. חלק ניכר מיהדות אשכנז זה גרים. כן. עכשיו, בואו נמשיך. Let's continue. So I would like to tell you about Rabbi Chanina ben Tardayon. I would like to tell you something. it says about him that the Romans, because he used to teach Torah, and they did not allow him to teach Torah, not allow anyone to teach Torah, he used to sit down with a book of Torah on him. So they caught him and they decided to burn him. And they decided to kill his wife and the daughter that wasn't married to Rabbi Meir Balanes, the other daughter, they put her in jail where, you know, jail in the place of prostitution. In that place they put her. And it says, Bruchaba. And yes, Laburia, her sister. And I would like to tell you what happened. It says that Rabbi Chanina ben Tardayon, when they took him to burn him, they took the book of Torah. They put the book of Torah around him. They took wool and they put water. They dipped it in water. They put it inside near his heart so he will burn slowly. And his suffering will be very, very hard. And they started burning him. And it says that once he was starting to burn, his student said, Rabbi, open your mouth so the fire will go into your mouth and kill you quickly. But he said, I didn't give myself the soul. The one that gave the soul to me, he will take it in his time. And his daughter was crying. And it says that his daughter was telling him, Father, what shall I do? How can I help you? And he said, you cannot help me, he said. You shouldn't feel bad for me, because if I was only the one to be burned, he said, then you should feel bad for me. But I'm not burned alone. I'm burned with a book of Torah, he said. Sorry. I had infection in my throat, and I didn't finish with it yet. כן, אולי כן. So, dear women, please listen.
Over there,
the bar. Let
me get.
So, it says, בגלל שהוא לימד תורה ברבים, והיה אסור. He taught Torah to a lot of people in public, and they did not allow the Jewish people to teach Torah at all. But he did that in front of everyone, exactly. So I would like to tell you, dear women, he said to his daughter, if I was burnt alone, you should feel sorry for me, but I'm not burnt alone. I'm burnt with a book of Torah. And because of that, when a God will want to revenge the Torah, he will have to revenge my death too. And it says that the students were asking, Rabbi, what do you see? He says, you know what I see? I see that the book of Torah is burned, but the letters from the book of Torah are flying in the sky. I can see the letters leaving the book and flying in the sky. I can see the letters, he says. So the executor, which saw with him what he was seeing, yes, it was Roman. He saw what he was seeing. The executor said, Rabbi, if I help you to die quickly, would you take me with you to the next world, to the true world? So he told him, yes, I will. He said, swear to me that you're going, Mishavali. Swear to me that you're going to take me. He says, I will. So, Atalian, the executor. So the executor took out the wool with the water from out of his heart, around his heart it was. So he took it out. And once he took it out, he jumped into the fire himself, and both of them were burned at the same time. And then a voice came out from heaven and said that both of them have a part in the next world. They're welcome to the next world. So the rabbi said, there's one who buys his next world in 1 hour, and there's one who buys their next world in a few years. Whole life.
Who was this guy that's the executioner?
שהוא היה אחת מהניצוצות של קדושה שיצאו מהאדם הראשון והגיעו לשם והיה צריך להתעורר והוא התעורר כשהוא ראה את רבי חנינה בן תרדיון נשרף. So it's like it's the same thing like Naon, the general. It's the same thing that Naon, the general, that woke up and decided, wow, I have to convert to Judaism because God is... It's big. He's the only one. He's the one that decides what's going to go in this world, what's going on in this world. We think that we control our life, but we do not really control our life.
I think we studied Greek and Roman history. They never mentioned that Nero converted.
Converted to Judaism, and one of his descendants was Rabbi Meir.
They never discussed that.
I would like to tell you more about him. Now, who was? אז צריך להפסיק את זה שתי דקות. אבל לא, שנייה, עוד כמה רגעים. שפי שם, סיגי, עוד שנייה. Dear women, לא נורא, עוד שנייה. אני רוצה להגיד לכם על רבי חנינה בן תרדיון. רבי חנינה בן תרדיון. I just finished antibiotics. That's why I must say. In a few minutes, I will tell you. Who was רבי חנינה בן תרדיון? I told you, להוציא יקר מזלל. To extract good from evil. So I would like to tell you. You remember Dina? You remember Yaakov Avinu, Parashat Vayishlach? We just read it a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
So you remember that Dina was the daughter of Leah Imenu.
Yeah.
And she decided to wander in the streets. Now, you know, Kol Kvuda Bat Melech Pnima, which means as a Jewish woman, you are not supposed to wander like this and look at the people that are the goyim over there. You're not supposed to wander outside. So she decided to wander outside. To walk around. Here, I'll give you the pasuk straight from the Torah. It says, "Vatetze Dina bat Yaakov lirot bivnot haaretz." Very weird for Dina bat Yaakov. She was righteous. She was the sister of the 12 tribes, the 12 brothers. It's not a usual woman. She was bat melech, a daughter of a king. So it says, why did she wander? And what happened? Shechem ben Chamor, Shechem the son of Chamor, which was a son of a king, he saw her. And immediately when he saw her, he fell in love with her. And he took her and he knew her, you know, intimately he knew her. And then he brought her back to Yaakov. It says he put her with him over there. And he told his father, Chamor, to go to Yaakov and to tell him that he wants to marry her. And when the brothers heard that, they said, this cannot happen to the children of Israel. Kazeh davar nevela lo yachol likol la'am Yisrael. So they decided to tell them to circumcise themselves. They said, if you be Jewish like us, then we can get married. So Chamor went to the people of the city. He was the king of the city. And he told them, listen, my son Shechem wants to marry Dinah, the daughter of Yaakov. And you know that they are wealthy, you saw, because when they went out of Lavan, when they left Lavan, Yaakov left with a lot of property. So they are wealthy, they are good looking, they are strong. So we'll give them our daughters and they will give us their daughters. But first, each one that comes into the city, we have to circumcise him. So they circumcised all of the boys, all of the men in the city. And then Shimon Belevi, they come at the third day after they made the circumcision, Beyom HaShlishi Shel HaMila, and they kill all of them. They kill all of them for what they did. You know, even Bnei Noach. You remember that I taught you the seven mitzvot, the seven commandments of Bnei Noach? They are not allowed to do such things. They now also have the law that they are not allowed to be intimate in a false way. They understand? Not in a right way. So they killed all of them. But the question is, think about it. Dinah was so righteous. Yaakov Avinu was so righteous. Leah was so righteous. How come such a decree from heaven came upon them? Such sorrow. They were crying, all of them. The shame, the dishonor that they had. How did this happen to them? So, Livriyut. So it says in the Midrash, Rabbi Chaim ben Atar says a beautiful, Zechutot Hagenelim, says a beautiful thing about it. He says when the first human being made the sin of eating from the tree of knowledge, then there were souls that came out of him, good souls that went into the Sitra Acha, which means into bad people. And like I told you, the Arizal says also, that they're inside and they are looking for a way to be freed. Now, I told you that the men have all of the future generations in their mind. All of the descendants that are supposed to come from them are over here in their mind. Everyone that is supposed, all the children that your husband is supposed to have is over here. And once he gives his sperm to his wife, she is the one that carries the child, but she helps him to carry mina koach el apoal. You understand? So, Look what happened. Shechem ben Hamor had a very righteous soul inside him. And the soul was the soul of Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon. But he was impure. Ulaya tahor. And the soul could not go out of him. He had to find a kindled soul, which means a soul that is just like him. He had to go to Dinah and to put that soul inside Dinah. And that soul, once he was intimate with her, went into Dinah. And one of the hadith sentences is Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon. And how did Rabbi Chaim ben Atar know that? Because at the end of the sentence, when we look in Parashat Vayishlach, it's written that Hamor, the father of Shechem, tells his people, our land is very wide. We can share it with them. So it says, Rachvat Yadayim, in Hebrew. And if you look it up in the Chumash, you'll see it's so beautiful. למי? בטח, אוסנת, התחתנה עם יוסף. לא דינה, אוסנת. אני אגיד עוד רגע. ולבואו להסביר, let me explain. So it says in chapter 34, חומש בראשית, sentence, verse 21, it says, רחבת ידיים. רחבת. That our land is very big, is very wide, we can share it with them. So Rabbi Chaim ben Atar, Zchutot Haganah, says about it. Here is a clue about Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon, because the Reish is Rabbi, the Chet is Hanina, the Bet ben Tardayon. Do you see that? Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon. You see over here that he was a soul that was inside Shechem ben Hamor, Shechem the son of Hamor. And once he was intimate with Dinah, this soul transferred into Dinah, which means that a pure soul came back to a pure person. It came back to the root of its being. Look how God works in different... So it says, it's a very nice, it says, Yaakov is crying, Leah is crying, Dinah is crying, they're all suffering, but Hashem is sitting up there and smiling because he knows that he just passed the soul of Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon back to the children of Israel.
He's the father-in-law of
Rabbi Meir Balanes.
Ken. So this really explains how sometimes you meet people, very simple, very humble, not educated, they have incredible children that come out of them.
So Nora Lilad Nadam, it says in chapter 66 in Tehillim, it says like this. It says Lechu Umifalot Elokim Nora Lilad Nadam, which means God's work, he does all the stories. You know, he writes all the stories, he knows them. We do not see it. We see the suffering right now, but we do not see in the future what will happen with it. So look how beautiful it is. And I would like to tell you that Dinah had a daughter that her name was Osnat. And the children... And the... Ma? Wait. Ma? Abba shela yashchem ben chamor. Betach! Matara hayta shenitaber mimeno. So she had a daughter that her name was Osnat. And then Yaakov Avinu sent her out of the house because her brothers wanted to kill her. Because they didn't want a child to come out of her because it was of Shechem ben Hamor, the son of Hamor. So he sent her to Egypt. She came to Egypt and Potiphar took her and he raised her as his own because he did not have children. Potiphar, the one that took Yosef to jail, that his wife wanted Yosef to be intimate with Yosef. Look how God makes the stories. So he raised her because she was orphaned, she didn't have anyone. He raised her as his own. He took her as his daughter.
Now,
ההבדל, בואי אני אגיד לך לפני הרבה שנים, ההבדל אם הגיור הוא גיור אמיתי, היום זה לא כמו שהיה פעם, אנחנו לא מדברים על אותה רמה של רוחניות, זה אין מה להשוות בכלל. אם הגיור אורתודוקסי, אם היא חובשת, אם היא שמה מטפחת, אם היא שומרת הלכות, לא, אבל אז הם היו יהודים באמת, הם לא עשו אליעזר, עבד אברהם שהיה כנעני, אליעזר, which was the servant of Abraham, he was כנעני, and he was cursed to be a ruler, he was cursed, and it says that he converted to Judaism, but he did everything, he even looked like Abraham Avinu, מרוב שהוא עשה הכל כמו שצריך. A true conversion to Judaism has to be by the Jewish law, period. Otherwise, it's not a Jew. There's no questions about it. It's written in Shulchan Aruch, even in the Torah, we have in Megillat Rut. So there's no, if you are not converting to Judaism by the true Jewish law, not but in the true way, in the right way, and then a converted woman or a converted man has to keep all of the Torah, from Aleph to Taf. Everything, otherwise is not Jewish. No, it's not enough. By the Jewish laws, it's not enough. So I would like to tell you, dear women, this is the story of Rabbi Hanina ben Tardayon. But there's another story which I wanted to tell you about the sons of Rabbi Meir Baal Haness. I know it's late, but you'll have to bear with me. The sons of Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, I told you that they passed away during his lifetime. Shelo neda. And it says, it's a big story, that it was on Shabbat. And after the Kiddush, Shacharit, Osim Kiddush, after that, before Mincha, his sons died in at home. They were small children. They passed away at home, and Bruya, his wife, saw that they don't have life in them anymore. She didn't know what to do, but it was Shabbat before Mincha, and her husband, Rabbi Meir Baal Haness, she used to call him Rabbi, was in the shul, the Beit HaMidrash. So he was in Beit HaMidrash, and she did not know what to do. So she said, what shall I do? My two diamonds, my two sons that were supposed to be the torch of the Torah, the light of the Torah. They're supposed to be the light of the Torah, the torch of the Torah. They're supposed to continue my husband. The two diamonds that God gave me, what shall I do with them? It says that she took them and put them in their bed and she covered them. Now, meanwhile, she was eating herself from the inside. She had such sorrow that she said, you are not allowed to cry on Shabbat. So she did not know what to do. She decided with herself that she won't say anything to her husband. She will let him come from shul, do the Avdalah, and do Melaveh Malkah, and only after that she will say. She will not say anything to anyone. Rabbi Meir Baal Haness came home. And when he came home, he says, wife, where are my sons? They were not in Beit HaMidrash. I didn't see them. She says, well, I'm surprised because they went to Beit HaMidrash. So he said, how come they're not here? She said, maybe they went to a different place. You know how small children behave. Maybe they went to a different place. So she gave him the candle and everything for Abdallah, and he did Abdallah. After he finished the Abdallah, he again said, it can't be that they're not here. They won't be with Abdallah. So something, what happened? So she said, nothing, I'm sure they went to the neighbors or somewhere else. I'll look for them. But meanwhile, she prepared the table for Melaveh Malkah. So he was singing, he was davening, he was blessing. They were eating Melaveh Malkah, the dinner of Melaveh Malkah. And then when they finished, she was waiting. And she said, Rabbi, I have a question about a Jewish law. Rabbi, a person came to me and gave me a deposit, she says. Gave me a deposit. And you know what? He asked me and he wants back his deposit. But I don't know if I need to give him back the deposit that he gave me. So Rabbi Meir Baal Haness said, wow, yeah, you're a wise woman. You're a scholar. You give Jewish laws. And you're asking me if to give it back or not to give it. I know you know. Of course you have to give back the deposit. It's not yours. He gave you for a period of time. It's a pikadon. הוא נתן פיקדון, הוא רוצה שתחזירי לו. If he gave you a deposit, you have to bring it back, you have to give it back to him. So she said, well, I wanted to know that, to have the answer from you. I knew that this is what you're going to tell me. So she took her husband, she took her Bimir Balanes to the children's room. And there he saw two bodies covered. He saw the children, so he opened the cover and he was looking. And then it came to his mind that the children are dead. It says that he started crying, that nobody could comfort him. There was no one that can give him nechama. There wasn't any comfort. He was shouting, my sons, Rabotai, Rabotai, my rabbis, he said. You are my sons, Miderech Eretz, but you are my rabbis. I was studying Torah from you, from your wisdom, he said. He could not be comforted. His wife could not comfort him. She wanted to cry, but she saw that he is ruining himself. She couldn't cry. She had to help him. She said, Rabbi, but I just ask you, a Jewish law, and I ask if you have a deposit, and the owner of the deposit wants it back. You told me you should give it to him immediately. So she says, Hashem natan, Hashem lakach, yesh shem Hashem evorach leolam ve'ed. So she says, God gave us the deposit and God took the deposit. This is the time that he wanted to take the deposit because they finished their fixing. And it says that the Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was crying. Nobody could comfort him. Only his wife. And it says that all of the rabbis and even her father, which was the grandfather of her children, Rabbi Chanina Ben Tardayon, all of them said, this is Eshet Chayil Mi Imtza. Because you cannot find such righteousness in such a high level, of the spiritual level. Because this is... הייתה לו רק בת. בת ושני בנים. ושני בנים באותו יום שלא נדע נפטרו. ילדים קטנים. Sorry? They made the tikkun. When God decides that this is your fixing and you finished it, he takes in his time. את מה שהם היו צריכים בעולם הזה, את התורה שהם העבירו לו, את מה שהם צריכים להעביר לאנשים שנמצאים סביבם. This, you know, when God decides, God forbid, to take a person, this means that this is his time, because God will not take anyone if it's not his time. So if God decides, this person did all of the fixing, this is his time to go away from here now.
As she said that, the positive, you know, she was saying, you just gave
me
an answer, so...
Yes, that's how she tried to... Yes, that, yes, because he couldn't believe about her wisdom. Sorry?
If they going to say no, not to give the deposit back...
Oh, it doesn't matter. She wanted to comfort him. She wanted to give him a clue.
She kind of prepared.
Yes, she wanted to prepare, to give him a clue of what was happening. You know, just to give him a hint. That's why she spoke about the deposit, because the deposit was the neshamot. Everybody has shiubrim ibadu lechayim arukim, children, but the children is the property and the deposit of what God gave us. So God says you have to teach your children Torah. Take this deposit and teach them the right things in this world. Teach them to know me. Teach them to remember me. Teach them to love each other. That's what we are supposed to do in this world. This is our deposit, and we need to do the right thing with the deposit. So I would like to tell you, dear women, with this, you know, it's connected to Parashat Miketz. Parashat Miketz, it's written, Vayi Miketz Shnatayim Yamim. It's written, Vayi, that's how it opens Parashat Miketz. Vayi Miketz Shnatayim Yamim. It says at the end of two, instead of years, it's 2 years, Shnatayim, it's 2 years, and over here it's days. So the Midrash says, why do they write Shnatayim, 2 years, and then they end it with days? So it says in the Midrash that there was a rabbi that he went, elevated himself to higher spiritual levels. And once he was in the true world, he saw over there a place of judgment, a court. And he saw rabbis sitting, and he saw two people. One of them was a young boy, barely 20 years old, and one of them was, like it seems, an old man, like 80 years old. So over there, the judges called the young boy an old man, Zaken. Zaken, it's Milshon in Hebrew, Kavanai, it means that he was a wise person, a knowledgeable person in the Torah. And the old person, they called him a young person. So he said, the rabbi said, excuse me, he says, am I in the true world, Ba'olam Ha'emet? Because I can see, why are you kidding with those two people? Don't you see that this is barely 20 years old, this neshama, and this neshama is over 80 years old? So the rabbis over there told him, the righteous judges told him, yes, but this one that is barely 20 years old learned and studied Torah and all of the Pardes in all his life, more than this old person in all of his 80 years. This one, this young person, every day of his life is considered like a year because he studied Torah, he did mitzvot and good deeds, he did everything. He did good deeds, ma'asim tovim, mitzvot, the commandments, he fulfilled everything. So every day of his life is like a year. But this, God gave him such a long period of time because he wanted to see what he's going to do with his life. Maybe he will remember me. But the things that he did is only like considered like a few days. So it says, Vayehi, every place in Megillat, in Masechet Megillah, it says that every place that is written Vayehi, that starts with the word Vayehi, this is a word of sorrow. Which means that if a person at the end of his life, his years are considered as days, he has a big problem. Do you understand? If his years that he lived, like his 40, 50, 60, 70 years, and his years, when he goes to the next world, are considered only as days, it means that he did not do what he needed to do in this world. And we came to fix ourselves in this world. I would like to give you a story. You want one story about Rabbi Meir Balanes?
Yes.
Okay, about a Shalom Bayit. How he made peace at home between a husband and his wife. It says that Rabbi Meir Balanes had beautiful stories. When he taught Torah, everybody wanted to come to hear his Rasha, his Torah lesson. So it says that once there was a woman, and you know, it's really like today, it's, it resembles today, because the woman at the house was very spiritual. A high-level spiritual woman. She went to Shu'ei Torah, to Torah lessons, but her husband didn't want to go to Torah lessons. He didn't want to go to hear Rabbi Meir Balanes. He wanted to stay home. But he let her go on Friday night to hear the drasha of Rabbi Meir Balanes. But usually he told her, before the lights, the candle lights, will extinguish, you have to come back home. So one day, it was Friday night, she listened to his drasha, but it was so long that when she came back, the light was already extinguished. So her husband was so angry, he shouted at her. He did not let her come into the house. He said, you have to go to the rabbi and spit in his face. And only after you do that, you can come back home. She went to her neighbors. She didn't know what to do. She can't go to Rabbi Meir Balanes and spit in his face. So she didn't know what to do. For 3 weeks, she was sitting with her neighbors. She lived with them. She couldn't go back home. Because her husband swore that she won't come back home if she does not spit in his face. So Rabbi Meir Balanes saw in Ruach HaKodesh, in prophecy, what happened. So he announced, after 3 weeks, he announced, dear women, I have a problem in my eye. My eye is sick. A woman that can whisper a sgula in my ear and spit in my face, in my eye, should come and do that. So her neighbor said, you know, they were good neighbors. Wow, this is your chance. We are taking you to Rabbi Meir Balanes. You have to do that. So, you know when you have friends, they're pushing you to go. She didn't want to do that. She said, I don't know how to whisper. I don't know any sgula. What shall I whisper? She said, I don't know anything. They said, it doesn't matter. They pushed her, you know, they pushed her, they made her go. So she went over there, and she was standing in front of them. They said, she knows lilchosh. She knows how lilchosh, she knows how to whisper, she knows the word, she knows how to speak. Everything's okay. But while she was standing in front of him, she had a lot of honor and respect towards him. She couldn't do that. She can't lie to the rabbi. So she was standing over there, and she was looking at Rabbi Meir Balanes. And she, and then, you know, barely, you can barely hear her. And she was saying, Rabbi, I'm so sorry, but it's not true. I don't know how to whisper in the ear. I don't know how to spit or to do it. I really don't know. So the rabbi looked at her and said, you know what? It's okay. Because your friend said that, you know, you should come. And I would like you to spit in my eye 7 times. Well, the rabbi told her, she spit in his eye 7 times. When she finished, he told her, go back to your husband. Tell him that he told you to spit only once, but you did it 7 times. So the students around Rabbi Meir Balanes, the students were shocked. He says, Rabbi, this is the Torah and this is the respect of the Torah? You should have told us what her husband said. We would go to him and hit him so hard that he will say that he's sorry and he will get back his wife back home. But Rabbi Meir Balanes said no. He said, should my honor be more than the honor of Hashem? So they did not understand what he was saying. So he explained. He said, Hashem, you know, יש לנו במסכת סוטה, when a woman is her husband thinks that she made adultery, which means that she was with another man while she's married to him. He goes to the priest, he goes to Jerusalem, to the temple, and over there they give her something to drink. Mesotah, it's called. So they write on an amulet the name of Hashem. They put it inside the water, and then the name goes off the amulet into the water. The woman drinks that. If she is not guilty, she becomes pregnant and she has a righteous son. But if she is guilty, she dies and the man that made adultery with her dies at that minute. Both of them die at that minute by the water because the name of God is inside it. So Rabbi Meir Balanes said, if God does it, wipes his name from the amulet into the water in order that there will be peace between a husband and wife, I can let her spit into my eye in order that they will have peace. This was Rabbi Meir Balanes. Bli Neder, his Yahrzeit is on the 14th of Iyar, and I'm going to tell you a lot of stories then about Rabbi Meir Balanes. But meanwhile, I would like to speak about the Jewish laws of Hanukkah before I send you home. I can't send you home like this. So I would like to tell you, first of all, Parashat Miketz is connected to Hanukkah. If you look over here at the word Shnatayim, 2 years. So our sages say, Shin is small, is the left side. Nun is Nerot. Taf is Tadlik. The Yud is Yemin. The Mem is Mezuzah. Each word from the word Shnatayim stands for each letter in the word Shnatayim, 2 years, stands for a word, small Nerot Tadlik Yemin Mezuzah, which means, yes, Shnatayim, 2 years. Yes. So small Nerot Tadlik, which means on the left side of the door you light the candles of Chanukah, and on your right side of the door you have the mezuzah. So you'll have a lot of mitzvot surrounding you. It is said that we need to light the candle, the candles of Chanukah, on the left side of the door. So when you come into the house, you will be surrounded with mitzvot all around. On your right side, you'll have the mezuzah. On your left side, you're going to have the Chanukah candles. So it's look how beautiful it is. Today, you'll see there are some people in an aquarium put the Chanukah, the Chanukiah, can, bli mayim, only the box, you know, the glass. And they put the Chanukiah inside and they put it, you'll see rabbis who put it near the house on the left side of the door. You'll see it some.
That's what they do in Israel, they don't
do that. They also over here do that. In Brooklyn, I saw a few places, can. Chabad do that, a lot of Chabad do that too. Ine, the small Nerot Tadlik Yemin Mezuzah. It says that the Mehadrin, they light a candle for each child. Each person in the family lights his own Chanukiah. Okay? Sorry? Yes, but you'll see that also a lot of Sephardic do that. It's Listen, the Mehadrin It says, Mitzvot ner Chanukah ner ish uveito, which means one Chanukiah for all of the house. But, ve'amehadrin ner lechol nefesh v'nefesh, which means the one that decides, usually those are the Ashkenazi people, that they give each child a Chanukiah. They light the Chanukiah, each one of them separately. I would like to tell you, on Chanukah we say the full Hallel. You'll see that on Rosh Chodesh we say only part of the Hallel, Chatzi Hallel, but on Chanukah we say the full Hallel. You know that chapter 30 in Tehillim is the chapter of Chanukah. Okay? Shir Chanukat Abayit LeDavid. 30, yes. 30. Mizmor Shir Chanukat Abayit LeDavid. This is chapter 30 in Tehillim. This is the chapter of Chanukah. It's good to read it every day. When you light the candles, read it. I told you when you light the candles, you have to lechaven, to see the letters. Write it over here. Nachal. Nachal is spring. Nachal. Nachal. You have to lechaven because it's the first letters of the word shh. Notzer chesed lealafim. One of the 13 measures of Hashem. You see, notzer chesed lealafim nachal. Which means finds kindness. He gives kindness to thousands of generations. This is one of the 13 measures of Hashem. So when you light the candles, think about the word Nachal. Chanukah Sameach. Think about the word Nachal. When you put the candles, you put them from the right side, from right to left. When you light the candles, it's from left to right, okay? You remember that right is the side of kindness and left is the side of judgments. Okay, so we light the candles from the side of judgments towards the side of kindness, so we'll have kindness upon us. Okay, it's yes, from left to right we light them. כן. את האחרון מדליקים ראשון, את שמה את הנרות מימין לשמאל, ואחר כך הם משמאל לימין את מדליקה אותם. כן, 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 כן. את יכולה להדליק את זה או להדליק קודם את משמאל לימין ואחר כך את השמש. Dear women, let's continue. Okay, on Friday you need to light the candles before we light the candles of Shabbat. On Shabbat, when we do Havdalah, there are two different things that we do. In the shul, we light the candles of the Chanukiah before Havdalah. The rabbi lights the Chanukiah before the Havdalah. But when you come back home, you do the Havdalah and then you have, at home you have to do the Havdalah and then you light the candles of Chanukah. Okay, but in shul, they first light the candles of Chanukah and then they do the Havdalah. Why? Because in shul it takes more time before Shabbat goes out because you sing, you say Divrei Torah, it takes longer. And because our sages were afraid that the people will go back home and they will not light the candles of Chanukah, so it is, they light the candles before the Havdalah and then once they do the Havdalah, everybody goes home. But at home we have to do the Havdalah and then lighting of the candles, okay? Don't forget to add Al HaNisim in Tefillat Shmona Esrei. We say Al HaNisim and Birkat HaMazon. When we say Birkat HaMazon, we say also Al HaNisim. And another thing, don't forget on Rosh Chodesh, Yom Shlishi, Yom Revi, on Tuesday and Wednesday. You have to add not only Al HaNisim, also Yaleh Ve'Yavo, Bebirkat HaMazon, ve'gam Batfilot Shmona Esrei. Because the Rosh Chodesh, Yaleh Ve'Yavo, ve'Al HaNisim. Both of them you have to add. And I would like to remind you that we read every day from the first day of Chanukah, every morning when they read from the Torah, they read about the presidents, Hanesim, 12 Hanesim Shel HaShvatim. They read all the things that they brought for the Mishkan. You remember that the children of Israel, after they built the Mishkan in the desert, where Hashem was over there, he put his Shechina inside. So then each president came and brought his gifts for the Mishkan. Et ha-mincha shelo. So we read every president every day. And on the eighth day, it's called Zot Chanukah. We'll speak about it next week. It's called Zot Chanukah. This is Chanukah. We read all from the 8th president till the 12th. We read everything on that day, Bezrat Hashem. And I would like, please, to tell...
Okay. What's so special on that day of Zot Hanukkah, which is a mesugal ledvarim?
זה מה שאני הולך לדבר אתכם בלי נשא שבוע הבא כבר. אני אדבר איתכם. אנחנו בדיוק נהיה בזאת חנוכה. So I would like to wish all of you בעזרת השם חנוכה שמח. ובעזרת השם שיגיע משיח תתנו במרב אבינו אמן. ובעזרת השם שיגיע מבשר אליהו נביא אליהו תשבילה ובמרב נמשך בן דוד אליהו נזכור לטוב. ועולם יפרד אדם מחברו בדבר הלכה יחיד ברבים הלכה כרבים. God bless you.